auzi tu, dragă drăguță, mi-ai cerut ciorac cu panglicuță. Și-ai mai vrea, și-ai mai vrea, și-ai mai vrea, mă tale, să-ți cumpere neica și sandale.
Hello, Rabbi Asa. We are in beautiful sunny Fullerton, California. Today is Tuesday afternoon, a lovely, lovely evening, about 7:30, May 21st, 2013. And I am pleased to introduce to you again story number 13, I think, a special story today with Rabbi Haim Asa from Burgas, Bulgaria, now in Fullerton, California. Rabbi Asa.
Thank you, David. Today I would like to discuss the role or the entire concept of the labor brigades in Bulgaria, in Romania, and other places. What does it mean? Well, let me backtrack to Hitler. Hitler wanted the king of Bulgaria, King Boris III, to do two things. One is send Bulgarian troops to the Eastern Front, that's Russia, to fight the Russian army. And obviously Hitler needed help, because after December of 1942, January 43, the destiny or the conclusion of the World War, of the Second World War, was already decided, and Hitler needed help. The second thing that Hitler wanted from King Boris is that he surrender the Jews to the Nazi plan of resettlement, or better known as extermination, in the East, in Poland. Now, every meeting that the Führer, Hitler, and the Bulgarian king had was very, very tense. Every word was weighed carefully to see what does it mean. And as a matter of fact, the king, who died unfortunately in August 1943, after the conclusion of the unsuccessful attempts to send us to the East, I think that Hitler invited King Boris to come to his eagle's nest, which was really the hiding place of Hitler, or the headquarters away from civilization. And at that place, we are told by reporters that Hitler really screamed like a madman at King Boris, telling him exactly what he wants. And the king very politely said that A, he cannot assign Bulgarian troops to the Eastern Front, because the Russians and the Bulgars, or Bulgarian people, are of the same Slavic race and background, and that Russia liberated Bulgaria from the Turkish yoke in 1876 or whatever it was, and therefore we could not now fight against the Russians. And the second thing that Hitler wanted from King Boris was the surrender of the Jewish community of Bulgaria to be shipped to the East. He tried that twice, in March of 1943 and in May of 1943, and both attempts failed. Now, one reason that the attempt failed was the king said to Boris,
Hitler said to Boris?
The king said to Hitler,
may he rot in hell?
Yeah.
Hitler, I mean.
Yes, may he rot in hell. That I need every labor force available to me or to us, the Bulgarian people, to build highways and to build bridges and to build schools and to basically revive the infrastructure of the country. Therefore, I'm going to use the Jewish people, the men. Women were not recruited into the labor brigades. If it were today, probably women would have been also part of it. But he said, I need to mobilize to literally recruit all the Jews to do slave labor free of charge to rebuild Bulgaria. And this was his constant argument. Now, what is the genius, or what is the really the wisdom of that particular argument? Yes, Hitler did use Jewish labor in Auschwitz and every place where there was industry to create anything from A to Z, basically. In Auschwitz, the big electrical giant Siemens, which today is probably number two or number three in the world in electrical
products.
And even Mercedes-Benz had a factory in Auschwitz, let alone Farben, F-A-R-B-E-N, the chemical giant, still today, which had big industry in Auschwitz, where Jews were employed as slave laborers, and after 3, 4, 5 months, the Jews became initiated, literally skeletons.
Skin and bones, yes.
Skin and bones, and the word for it was Musliman, which has something to do with the Muslim religion, but I don't know why in the German language this became sort of known as a skeleton, as person, skin and bones.
Ready to die.
Ready to die. Now, in Bulgaria, the king mobilized or recruited, involuntarily of course, all the Jews from age 18 to 45 or whatever the age limit was. I know that because my father was not recruited. My father was not mobilized.
Him being over a certain age.
Yeah, being over, yeah, my father at that time was 50. So he was out of the age limit. But those people were taken to the most neglected parts of the country. I don't have any examples from the United States of America, but I would say maybe after the Civil War in this country 150 years ago, that parts of the country that were decimated by the Civil War, by the way, the Civil War was the war where more Americans died on both sides of the conflict than any other war in the history of the United States of America. More than the First War, more than the Second World War, more than Vietnam and Korea. Combined together, they could not make up for the losses of the Civil War. But the idea was to send those labor brigades to do the work that nobody would do, even for a great pay or for a great compensation. So, the fact that he could use the argument, I need the Jewish labor to rebuild the country, worked, and Hitler had no answer to that because obviously Boris said, my Jews are my slave labor,
right,
and that's all I need.
I think the same thing happened in Romania with King Carol.
Exactly.
Who had the same policy, which we will explore in a different story. Tell us, what would you like to speak to tell our audience in story number 14?
Well, I would like to talk about the assassination or the death. It wasn't really assassination. It was a poison, probably used for to kill the Bulgarian king.
And King Boris III.
King Boris III. And I'll tell you more about it in the next segment.
Thank you very much, Rabbi Asa.
Thank you, David.
Thank you very much. And stay tuned for story number 14. Și-ai mai vrea, și-ai mai vrea, drăguță Ana, ca să te îmbrac, măi, conă framă. Să-ți cumpăr, să-ți cumpăr cercei, măi, Ana, dar eu n-am de unde, măi, coadană. Auzi, dragă, fata nechi dragă, aseară colină ta miceană. Și acum nu sparale, să-ți cumpăr sandale, buzunarele sunt goale, da. Mai apui, drăguță, încă o băncuță și băui